profesor Rao. Dr. Singh sir, you missed his talk at Dhanbad that he delivered at our CBM training program.
Okay, IIT
Bombay. Professor A.B. Rao is an associate professor at the Indian Institute of Technology, Bombay. He teaches courses at Sitara, Department of Energy Science and Engineering, and IDP in Climate Studies. He is guiding several doctoral and master's students. Professor Rao holds bachelor and master's degree from IIT Bombay and a doctoral degree in Engineering and Public Policy from the Carnegie Mellon University, USA. He is currently the principal investigator of the Rural Technology Action Group at IIT Bombay. He is also heading the CTWG Act project at IIT Bombay. Professor Rao has several publications to his credit. One of his papers has been cited more than 1,200 times on Google Scholar. So with this brief introduction of Professor Rao, I request Professor Rao to kindly give his address on CO2 capture and storage in coal gasification projects. Professor Rao, please.
Namaskar. First of all, I realize that I have made a great mistake. In a very unconscious moment, I agreed to Professor Dr. A.K. Singh that I will give this lecture. I was not aware that the kind of scale of this event. So please pardon me if what I am going to say sounds to be very naive. And I also know that this is like a end of a long day of deliberation. So I can understand how fatigued everybody would be. But still, since Dr. Singh has brought me all the way from Mumbai, I had to do justice to that 1 hour that I was supposed to deliver. But I tried to shorten it as much as possible so that it doesn't get very boring for you. First of all, I just like to give my acknowledgement for giving me this podium. Dr. Singh has been kind enough to invite me for this talk. Also, I had an interesting visit to Dhanbad for the first time. I also like to thank my advisor, PhD advisor, Dr. Rubin, who introduced me to this field of CCS, and all my students who have been working with me on this topic. So this is a brief outline I had planned. I'll try to modify it as we go along. But first, I'd like to tell you where I come from and the motivation for this topic, why we are talking about CCS in the first place, that is climate change issue. Then I'll talk about something about CCS, and then specifically CCS in the context of IGCC. And finally, I'll wrap up with some concerns and issues related to CCS. Since morning, when Professor Garg started talking about energy scenario and cleaner ways of using coal, the word CCS has been used so many times. IGCC has been elaborated. So I don't have probably much new to say, but I'll just try to consolidate what I have said already. I'll take a couple of minutes to tell you where I come from, because this is not something that IIT Bombay is known for. I come from a small center within IIT, which is called Sitara, that is Center for Technological Alternatives for Rural Areas. I am talking about CCS only because of my past karma, that is my PhD and postdoc work was on CCS, but now I do something else at Sitara. Sitara is a small center that was started in 85 in IIT Bombay to look at the requirements of rural areas and how IITs can contribute in some sense. We started our academic program, Masters in Technology and Development, in 2007, followed by our PhD program as well. And today we have a full-fledged MTech program which has 30 candidates admitted every year. Our main focus is on the bottom 80% of the society, that is all the marginalized and underprivileged sections of the society. And of course, various areas, including energy, water, etc., we work in. So one of the, of course, theme areas within which we work is energy. And this is how I look at my research area related to field of energy, that is the quest for sustainable energy solutions. So today we find that a lot of research is going on in field of energy, but why we are still not able to address the issues in the field level. And we have to find out what keeps people away from these so-called sustainable solutions, whether it is biogas, whether it is improved cook stoves. We have to understand what exactly happens at the field level and what are the, where exactly the shoe is pinching. And that has been my focus area, and I can acronym it as ACCESS. So access to cleaner energy is one of the themes that have been followed, but access itself can be expanded in various ways in terms of how we look at access to energy as an important issue for development of society. As I said, the motivation for this topic, carbon capture and storage, is in the problem of climate change. Whether we agree with this or not, there has been a lot of debate about whether climate change is a real problem or a myth. And I think we have been through this long debate about evidence of this problem, but now more or less there is a consensus that this is a real problem and we have to do something about it. Now the only question remaining is who should do what and who should take that first step, and that we are losing time in all that debate and discussion. And although there is enough evidence that is available, but still there is a delay in tackling that is going on, and whole humanity is going to face the brunt of it. So the question is, what can be a real action in terms of addressing the climate change issue, which is initiated by human action? So it is not we can leave everything to nature, but human beings have to solve this problem, because we are the people who have started using a lot of fossil fuel and sending carbon dioxide in the atmosphere. The question remains is whose responsibility it is. It is depending on how we look at the past emissions and who has contributed how much. And that's why the most of the questions remain: who has consumed how much of the carbon and who has how much of space available in the atmosphere. So this is how the world map look like if we apportion the carbon emissions associated with every continent, and we see that the so-called developing countries have very little contribution in the whole problem, and that's why the whole debate begins. This is a very unique problem. It is not only an environmental problem, but climate change is a very, very unique problem because it is a global problem. So not a single country can solve it, and that's why there will be always free riders and victims in this kind of a situation. It is a, also we have to consider the intergenerational and intragenerational equity issues while we look at climate change, and there is always a danger that we may pass off the tipping point where we bring the whole humanity closer to disaster. When we specifically consider India's position about climate change, although historically we have not been a major contributor to climate change, but now where we are standing today, we have a great potential to be part of the solution. Depending on how India progresses in terms of our energy requirement and how we get energy from, we can be part of the solution. Whether we follow the low carbon or green energy pathway, or we continue to grow as China did, will make a lot of difference to the world. And that's why it is our very much big responsibility in terms of how we grow. Secondly, although we like it or not, we are going to face disproportionate impacts of this problem. Already in many parts of India, we are already facing extreme events like cyclones, floods, and impact on agriculture is already felt. And some parts of coastal areas are already getting eaten up by the sea because of the coastal sea level rise. And in that situation, we cannot just ignore that we cannot do anything about this problem, because ultimately we have to face the brunt of this problem. So we have to have some kind of a balance in terms of how do we look at this problem. Whether we do any, take any action or not, it depends on how we look at this problem. So typically there are two ways in which we can respond to climate change. One is mitigation, that is what most of us are talking here today about, how to avoid the problem in the first place, how to minimize the emissions by going by cleaner or greener ways of energy production. And then we'll later talk about geoengineering as well. On the other hand, we have to consider adaptation also as an important strategy through which we can try to cope up with the impacts of climate change. So looking at geoengineering as a mitigation strategy, which is a more recent kind of a thinking, that we can think about the whole globe and try to maneuver our ways in terms of fixing this problem. So if you know that increasing temperature is going to cause a problem, then rather than fixing the source of this problem, that is large-scale fossil fuel combustion, we are trying to find other ways of restoring the thermal balance or restoring the atmospheric concentration of greenhouse gases. And there are many, many, pardon my word, crazy sounding ideas in this particular domain, including reflecting large amount of radiation by having mirrors in the space. So there are all kinds of ideas, whether it is ocean fertilization, and carbon dioxide removal or CCS happens to be one of such ideas in terms of how we can respond to this whole problem of climate change. So let me talk about what exactly we mean by CCS. It is capturing CO2 generated from any combustion source, from fossil fuel, concentrate it, transport it to a secure site, and ideally what we are committing to is storing it in a safe place till eternity, because we don't want to allow it to enter into atmosphere, because otherwise it will again contribute to the problem of greenhouse gas concentration. And that's why we have to go through this stages: capture, transportation, and then storage. And often what we don't talk about is the monitoring of the CO2. We have to ensure that it stays wherever we want it to be, and that is an important step. In literature, we also find there are a lot of photosynthesis-based sequestration techniques like forestry, microalgae. I'm not going to talk about those. In fact, those are more benign forms of carbon sequestration. But now today's focus area is on capturing CO2 from fossil fuel sources. That's what I'll talk about. And as I said, there are multiple options in terms of how do we capture this CO2, how do we transport it, how do we store it, where do we store it. And we have to look at the implications of all this. So the basic focus of this technology is on large point sources. We cannot go after small individual vehicles which are emitting CO2. That cannot happen. So we have to only target large point sources like power plants, coal combustion based power plants, or maybe cement production units, refineries, where we can point out these are the stacks which are emitting large amount of CO2 per unit area in the highest densities. And worldwide, we can identify maybe about 5,000 such point sources, which contribute to roughly about 30 to 40% of the CO2 that we emit into atmosphere. And that has been the target of CCS technology. So if you consider the conventional power plant, we are just trying to add one more unit in terms of cleansing whatever we are sending out of the stack, so that we can generate a concentrated stream of CO2 and then securely store it somewhere. So fundamentally, there are three basic ways in which we can capture the CO2, depending on the process in which we are generating the power. The most conventional one is we generate the power as we are doing it in the pulverized coal plant, and at the end of the plant or at the end of the pipe, we add on a carbon capture unit, which is most feasible for retrofitting situations. And that has been the widely accepted solution in terms of CCS. However, today we are going to focus on a pre-combustion CO2 capture, where rather than allowing the CO2 be generated in the first place through combustion process, we try to separate it out before the fuel gas goes into combustion chamber. And then there is fundamentally third way in which we can use oxygen instead of air. So all three processes are basically different types of gas-gas separation processes. Here we are talking about separating CO2 from majority nitrogen. Here it is a question of separating CO2 from hydrogen. And thirdly, it is separation of air, that is oxygen and nitrogen. So these are the three fundamental separation processes that are driving this. Then in terms of the CO2 storage option, again, saline aquifers or depleted oil and gas wells, as well as deep coal beds for enhanced coal bed methane recovery. So these are various ways in which we can store the CO2. Ocean also happens to be the largest sink where we can store large amount of CO2, and ultimately all the excess CO2 that is entering into atmosphere today will go into ocean. However, if we wait for nature to take place, natural flux is very low, and by that time we'll miss the bus. So ultimately it will all go into ocean, but currently we are not doing or allowing any ocean sequestration because we don't know what will be the implications for the marine life because of the pH increase. So this is the array of options that we have in terms of where that CO2 can be stored. And actually doing this kind of a sequestration. So this is a picture of a well which is in Norway, where they are storing CO2 for the last 2 decades, and the whole world is watching it like an experiment. Of course, as I said, monitoring is not often talked about, but we have to be very careful in terms of where all that CO2 is moving and what is happening with that CO2. So monitoring is also important. Considering the relevance of CCS, whether CCS has to be considered at all as a carbon management option, I would say in terms of the hierarchy of the options, the first and foremost thing that we need to do is improve the efficiency, maybe at the generation end or at the consumption end. The second level of mitigation strategies is using low carbon or non-carbon fuels, which we are doing in many cases, moving from coal to natural gas or biomass or maybe other renewables. And thirdly, if these are not enough to deliver amount of carbon mitigation that is required, then CCS may be considered as a next level of option. The beauty of this technology is it can be considered as a bridging technology, because we are so much adapted to use fossil fuels today, we cannot imagine our life without consuming coal or natural gas or any other fossil fuel. So till we find a permanent solution to move away from fossil fuels, this will be kind of a bridging technology. It will allow us to continue using fossil fuels, but without feeling guilty about doing that, because we are storing all the carbon dioxide somewhere. So this is the kind of a technique. And the crucial question to consider this as a carbon management option is how much CO2 can be stored. And the geologists are saying that there's enough capacity where we can store all that carbon. Next question, very important question, is at what cost? At what cost can we store each ton of CO2? And does it make sense to go for it rather than going for any other high cost options, maybe including renewables or efficiency improvement and so on and so forth? And even if people are ready to pay for it, is the technology ready today? So even if I want to do this and deliver this plant on field, whether I can have that technologically feasible? So these are the three questions that are still staring at this particular technology option. Now, before even this technology is ready to be deployed in the field, economists and modelers all around the world have a lot of faith in this technology. So if you look at any kind of projections about how the emissions are growing today and what is the most desirable scenario where we want to achieve in terms of restoring that 2 degree centigrade temperature change that is allowable, we have to fill this gap somehow. And we find that conservation or energy efficiency, renewables, nuclear, all these are not enough for us to meet that kind of a desirable pathway in terms of energy, in terms of the emissions. And we leave all this gap between the whatever is possible and whatever is desirable to the credit of CCS. So without having this technology ready for deployment, we have already said that it has a lot of promise, and only with this CCS in place, we can do some kind of a target achievement in terms of emission pathways. And as I said, there is enough storage potential. That's what the preliminary study says, that these are our annual emissions from all the power sector, and this is what is the estimated potential for storing CO2. So in terms of the capacity to store CO2, there is no question as of now. In terms of the economic potential, most of the studies say that if we consider that CCS is not available as an option, our overall mitigation cost will just go beyond management. So that's why everybody likes CCS as a solution, because then you can show that mitigation can be achieved at reasonable cost. Without that, it is not possible. And that is where the problem begins, that there is a lot of hope associated with the technology which is not ready today. And everybody is hoping that after 20 years, after 30 years, this tool will be available with us, and then we can achieve a lot of carbon management at reasonable cost. So let me come specifically to IGCC, which is the integrated gasification combined cycle plant, just to do justice to the topic that we are talking about gasification. So this is how the layout of a typical IGCC plant looks like. We have a gasifier which will generate the syngas. And this is after cleaning, the syngas go to the gas turbine and produce power. There will be secondary turbine and it will generate steam, and extra power will be generated. So this is the simple IGCC plant. Now what we are proposing is, once we have this syngas generated, separate out carbon dioxide from that syngas, so that before the gas goes into the turbine, the CO2 will be separated in the first place. The advantage is that the partial pressure of CO2 is much higher here, so the separation cost is much lower, which is against the post-combustion CO2 capture scenario, which is often considered as a feasible solution. Now, IGCC is not relatively new technology. There is some experience with IGCC, and worldwide there are plants of different capacities which are already existing today. Now, what is not there is in terms of combining IGCC with carbon capture. So we have different parts of the puzzle already ready today, but we don't have them at one place. That is the problem. So if you consider the typical fossil fuel based power generation scenario, we know that we are burning fuel with some oxidant to generate some fuel, flue gas. Now in case of post-combustion capture, what as I said, we do just a tail end fix to this scenario, so the retrofitting becomes very easy. We don't have to touch the existing power plant so that we can deliver this solution quickly. On the other hand, when we are talking about IGCC with CCS, what we are proposing is, once we gasify the pool, we have to go through shift and select salt capture of CO2, where we can produce pure hydrogen, which can then be sent to the gas turbine, and then what we are going to release is only a mixture of water with other gases like nitrogen. So in that case, we can just have this concentrated CO2 stream separated beforehand, which can be dealt with. So this is how we represent IGCC versus IGCC with CO2 control, where we have to include an extra reactor, that is a shift reactor, clean the gas, capture the CO2, and then send the fuel gas to power generation block. These are the details about the IGCC with CO2 capture block, where we have these additional three units to be included, and that's why it makes it very difficult for retrofitting of existing IGCC. So when we are deciding to put IGCC plant, we should know upfront whether we are going to have just IGCC plant or we want to control CO2 from this plant. We cannot later on add on CCS unit on top of an existing IGCC plant, which is the biggest problem with decision makers, that unless there is a policy to capture CO2 or control CO2 emissions, nobody is going to invest in this extra cost of including CCS unit in the place. IGCC with CCS has obvious advantages, as we talked about since morning. Gasification has a lot of eco-friendly techniques. It is reducing the pollution both in terms of SOx and NOx as well as particulates. It has lower energy penalty, that means how much energy is required per unit of CO2 that we are controlling. It gives us flexibility in terms of what we want to generate out of the power plant, whether we want to have hydrogen for chemicals or we want to have electricity. There is flexibility available with us, and it will give us some valuable byproducts as well. On the other hand, it has several limitations. First of all, being gasification is a very, very complicated chemical process, as we heard just now from Professor Mahajani. It is a very, very complicated chemical process. And traditionally, the power plant industry, which is kind of governed by mechanical engineers, probably it is very difficult for that mechanical engineering lobby to let go the power plants to chemical engineering lobby. So this is one higher level tussle that we see. There is ambiguity, as I said, whether we want to build a capture-ready plant. There can't be something called capture-ready IGCC plant. So we can't build the IGCC plant today, and 5 years down the line, we want to retrofit it for carbon capture. That cannot happen. So we have to know it upfront. There is uncertainty about use of low quality coal, especially for the case of India, where our coal is not that good quality. Whether IGCC can be a solution, that itself is a big question mark. Of course, one of the biggest hurdles here is that we don't have a large-scale demonstration project which can assure that this technology works. As I said, there are IGCC plants in place, there are carbon capture plants in place, but the combination does not exist. And that is something that is the biggest hurdle that we see. Of course, because it is a highly expensive proposition. So there is a high capital cost involved, and lack of experience makes it even worse to have capital lending for this kind of plant. So just to quickly compare these three options, where we have a conventional post-combustion CO2 capture versus pre-combustion, that is IGCC plus CCS. As I said, it is difficult to retrofit existing plant, and it is a very, very expensive proposition. In spite of all the good qualities that this technology may provide, and there are different stages in which all the different components of CCS already exist today. If you consider the global scenario of CCS, we find that there are projects announced all over the world. And if you just try to look at what type of projects are announced, we find that there are some operational CCS plants, but at a very small scale, not to the scale of a 1,000 megawatt typical power plant capacity that we have. And there is only one single pre-combustion CCS plant that we have. Then we have some non-power plant CCS projects that are already in place. Again, the scale is very low as compared to what we want to have delivered in the field. And only in case of some kind of a revenue stream coming out of it, like EOR application, then only CCS will have some incentive. Otherwise, nobody is going to invest in this type of technology. And if we just look at IGCC plus CCS projects, we see that many plants are announced but not yet taken off. So in fact, I have a longer list of plants which were projects which were announced but later on cancelled, including the famous Future Gen project that US had announced earlier. So there is a big question mark in terms of whether the technology will be delivered at all and what time it will be available. Another important application of CCS in case of gasification is also in the field of something called bioenergy plus CCS. So we can use biomass for gasification and then capture CO2. And this is the technology now being discussed a lot because actually it can deliver negative emissions. Because we are capturing CO2 through plants and then we are capturing the CO2 coming out of the combustion of that biomass. So that is the only technology that is able to deliver us negative CO2 emissions, which is very, very attractive on paper. But again, there are question marks in terms of whether it will actually take off. Now, in terms of understanding how the inclusion of CCS will impact the existing power plant, we should have some kind of a simulation before we actually take this decision to go for CCS implementation. And we developed an assessment tool called Integrated Environmental Control Model at Carnegie Mellon University. This is a model which is available in public domain. Anybody can go and download this. What it does is, it estimates the impact of including CCS in a power plant framework on its performance, cost, as well as other emissions. And we can have both conventional piece, pulverized coal power plant, IGCC plant, NGCC plant, any type of power plant can be simulated for the kind of fuel characteristics that you want to have. The model already has some kind of a default parameter values, but user can always give their own set of values so that they can get desired results. And it has a very user-friendly kind of a interface where we can configure a plant, set up some parameter values, and get the results. So one of the important considerations in terms of choosing this technology is a large amount of energy penalty that is associated with this process. In the whole effort to capture CO2, we end up losing part of the power plant output because we need to separate CO2, we need to compress CO2, we need to transport CO2. And that itself may lead to as high as 15 to 25% of the power plant output. That means a 1000 megawatt power plant may deliver as low as 750 megawatt itself. While doing good to the environment in terms of capturing CO2, you are yourself lowering the total amount of CO2, lower amount of electricity that you are delivering. Either that means you have to build more power plants and start with more coal extraction, which will have its own implication for environment. So that is a very big tussle in terms of whether CCS can be considered as an eco-friendly solution in the first place. The other aspect is in terms of the cost. Bulk of the cost is with respect to capture of the CO2, but even transport, sequestration, everything will amount some amount of cost. And then we have to consider what is the carbon price that is available in the market and whether CCS can compete as an affordable solution for carbon mitigation. And currently, definitely it cannot. Only thing, as I said, on paper it looks like capturing CO2 through IGCC seems to be more reasonable in terms of the cost of CO2 mitigation as compared to the post-combustion CO2 capture. However, I would say this is only a theoretical value because no such plant exists today. which has delivered this course. So that is the big lacuna here. And then there are several studies which give us range of numbers in terms of the energy penalty and the cost of carbon that is associated with these topics. Now let me just finally talk about what are the different concerns and issues about CCS. So one of the things that I would like to say, after working on CCS for about 10 years, typically people work on some technology for the PhD and become champions of that technology. After spending time on this technology, I have become like a cautioner of this technology. So because I know some inside out in terms of what this technology is able to provide. So I would just like to raise some concerns about this technology before we say that there is a lot of hope with this technology. First and foremost, as I said, technical feasibility. We still don't have large-scale deployment of this or demonstration of this or experience with this technology. So it is unfair to say that this technology will become available at a certain point of time because we don't have that confidence. I mean, the last 3 decades, people have been just having the same hope and saying that by the end of the decade, the technology will be deployed. But we are still far away from that kind of thing. And this is the kind of a map in terms of maturity of CCS technology and all the different pieces of the puzzle. There are different levels of deployment or commercial availability, and it will take certainly another 2 to 3 decades, I would say, in terms of actually having full-fledged large-scale demonstration plants in place, because nobody wants to invest in this technology. And unless there is a strong commitment to reduce carbon dioxide, there is no policy incentive to do that as well. The next level of concerns and issues are related to cost and societal acceptance. It is a very expensive proposition, and that's why unless there is again some kind of a stick that the policymakers put, nobody is going to put this kind of a technology in their own plants, and that's why economic viability itself is questionable. Also, why would public accept this technology? One of the things often compared against whether we want nuclear plants or CCS plants, if that is the choice given to you. I think it is an unfair comparison because there are long-term liability issues related to both these technologies, and public may not be aware of other kind of aspects related to this. Then what is the risk associated with the accidental leakage from these facilities? So that is also another important consideration we have to have in terms of the risk mapping of this technology. Yeah. Other aspects are related to the environmental issues. So one of the slight and tussle we have here is that in some sense we are going to have continued dependence on fossil fuels. And that's why in fact some kind of environmental NGOs like Greenpeace, they are in very peculiar fix whether to support this technology as an environmentally benign technology or oppose it. And in different chapters around the world, they take very convenient stance related to this, because one of the things that we are going to promote is the faster depletion of fossil fuels if we go for CCS. And then what was it, but if we end up having some leakage out of these facilities, then we would have enhanced the rate of CO2 accumulation in the atmosphere, and that will be really a disastrous situation. Finally, we have to also understand the legal and regulatory issues related to this. So we are here committing storage of this CO2 for centuries together, and we know that how relaxed our implementation of property rights and liability issues, especially in this country which has seen Bhopal tragedy. We don't have to go far off to understand what will be the implications of lack of regulatory mechanism in terms of who will hand over the liability for next 1,000 years and who will ensure that the facilities will be intact for that kind of a time frame. So somehow there is a lot of fear in terms of whether by supporting CCS research are we delaying the real action that is required in terms of reduction of actual energy consumption, or having more greener and benign ways of harvesting energy from renewable sources. So that is one of the biggest dilemmas that we have. So diversion of funds and efforts is something whether we can afford that. And there is also a possibility that we'll get some kind of CCS projects under CDM, the Clean Development Mechanism, where the Western world would like to try out this technology, not in their land, but our land. And that is also a possibility that exists. So somehow, after taking into account answers to all these questions, we have to find out whether it is worth trying and whether it can be made worthwhile. If it is still not worthwhile, but maybe it choose, probably it is imperative that the Western world, the saw the technical feasibility and viability issues before we can take it upon large scale. So let me just conclude by saying that yes, CCS is a potential mitigation option that is available, but it needs to overcome several barriers and challenges. That is without going. Without that, it is a non-starter. And of course, the key challenges are technical feasibility, scale-up, economic viability, and public acceptance. So although on paper, the IGCC plus CCS combination looks very attractive, it is yet to prove itself. That is what we are waiting to be proved. In terms of our priorities as a developing countries today, in fact, when about 50 million households don't have electricity connection even. So what we are in need of is enhancing our power generation capacity, and coal is the only backbone that we have. Improving the energy efficiency of our power plant, whereas CCS will derate our power plants and have the large energy penalty. Reducing the cost of power generation so that it can become affordable for our masses, whereas CCS is going to double the cost of power generation. So on all these counts, CCS does not seem to be priority for our country. And that's why it is obvious that government does not have large-scale CCS R&D projects or programs in place. But nevertheless, just to have flexibility for our future policy options, probably it is worthwhile to have some kind of a research program going on in CCS just to have as a low-cost insurance policy against the future uncertainty. So we should be aware of what we can do in terms of CCS, where are our potential storage sites, that kind of information we should have. But we cannot actively deploy this technology on our own because it is just infeasible in terms of the cost involved. So with that, I'll just end and have any questions answered if you.